the majority of our neurotransmitters that we usually think of operate in the brain are actually made in the gut. So the integrity of the gut has a massive impact on our cognitive function and our moods.
Welcome to Women's Health and Longevity by Seneca Women. We're living in an age of scientific breakthroughs. Technology, AI, and medical advancements are ushering in a whole new era of health and longevity. But what does that really mean for women's health? We're here to talk to experts about women's health from every angle, and we're here to demystify the science of health and suggest easy, practical things we can all do that may help us live healthier, happier, and longer.
Today we'll learn about the gut microbiome and why it can lead to better mood and overall health. We're talking to Dr. Karen Koffler.
So I want to talk about the microbiome, which I think we're all reading a lot about these days, but not many of us really understand. So what is the gut microbiome?
The microbiome is really the trillions of organisms, bacteria, viruses, parasites, yeast, fungi that live within our digestive tract.
Okay, that sounds a little scary. So is the gut microbiome a good thing or a bad thing?
They're supposed to be there. We need them there. They actually work with us to do a number of things. They help protect us from other invading organisms. They help us digest our food. They actually eat our fiber and secrete important compounds that protect the lining of the gut. They help us make and absorb nutrients, particularly vitamins like vitamin K for our bones. So we're actually very dependent on a healthy, balanced microbiome.
So how do we keep the microbiome healthy? Or as they say, how do we have good gut health?
Well, some of the things that actually injure or have an adverse impact on our microbiome include things like antibiotic use, Advil, ibuprofen, Motrin use, alcohol, aspirin. Many medications have a negative impact on the microbiome. Stress has a terrible impact on the microbiome, just like it has an ongoing effect on us. So avoiding those things as much as possible will help keep the microbiome healthy. And then feeding it well, actually feeding the bacteria what they enjoy eating, which includes plant-based foods. High fiber foods are actually fuel for the healthy bacteria that keep us in turn healthy.
You know, all the things you mentioned, many of us, of course, have taken a lot of antibiotics or take ibuprofen on a regular basis. So it's not too late for us, right? We can improve our gut health.
Absolutely. When we eat any kind of fermented foods like yogurt or kefir or sauerkraut or things like that, we're actually feeding ourselves probiotics, which actually helps reseed or reestablish a good microbiome. Some people take probiotics in pill form or powder form, which helps build back up our microbiome. And then avoiding those things as much as you can that we mentioned will help reinstate a healthy microbiome.
It seems to me that nutrition plays a really important role. What about stress? What kind of role does stress play on the microbiome?
Stress reduces blood flow to the gut, which reduces the gut's ability to create a barrier that allows the microbiome to thrive. And it seems to have a direct negative impact on the bacteria that live within our gut. So in a variety of ways, stress injures us as well as our microbiome.
So it seems like good nutrition, key, trying to manage stress, which seems to be a culprit in most disease and inflammation. And of course, we should talk about how to manage stress. But in terms of the microbiome, there's been a lot of talk lately about how your gut health has a relationship to other parts of your body, your mental function, your cognitive function, your brain health. There's this incredible gut-brain connection that we've been hearing a lot about. What's that about?
Absolutely. So first, the majority of our neurotransmitters that we usually think of operate in the brain are actually made in the gut. Things like serotonin and dopamine are actually created to a large extent in the gut. And by the way, some of that requires some of the activity of the good bacteria that live within our gut. The health of our gut lining and the ability to maintain that barrier helps reduce the amount of inflammatory compounds that can have a negative impact on our mood, on anxiety, on depression. So the integrity of the gut has a massive impact on our cognitive function and our moods.
Truly amazing. So it seems that, again, sort of being conscious of your gut health and making some inroads into improving gut health through nutrition, as you mentioned, through stress reduction. We're all pretty stressed out, living in a pretty stressful time. What do you recommend to reduce stress these days?
So there's no escaping stress. There's really developing a strategy, and it's very individual how we do go about this, but all of us are capable of developing a strategy that allows us to separate ourselves from a stressful event. And it does take effort, but we have shown over and over again, many studies have shown that adopting practices like meditation, like breathing, like prayer, like journaling, or gratitude practices. Some people go for a run, some people do yoga. Tai Chi and Qigong are practices that have been shown to be very effective towards lowering the stress response. So we can all find something that helps us, that gives us a skill for managing stress.
Well, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Here are my top takeaways. First, gut health affects not just your digestive system, but your mood and overall health. Second, to keep your gut microbiome healthy, choose a diet with plenty of plant-based and high-fiber foods. Lastly, reduce stress for a healthy gut. Consider practices like yoga, breathing techniques, and exercise. Join us for more episodes of Women's Health and Longevity Explained by Seneca Women.